ages. Oh, I'm going through so much right now, Jesus. Oh, I can't even understand. I can't even understand. But I know you're able. All I seem to do is hurt me, hurt me. Lord, deliver me.
Good morning and welcome to Chaldean Church's online Sunday service. Your welcome this morning comes from an unusual location. I'm standing in a pine wood in the middle of Northumberland, not far from our caravan. This morning our service will be a mix of praise, worship, kids talk from Esther, and a message from Corinne. The message is part four in our series of Blessed, Broken, Given. It's great to see Corinne back amongst us, and I'm sure Corinne's going to be speaking from the heart this morning. There couldn't be a more appropriate topic, bearing in mind that Corinne has had such a hard year this year. I'm sure she's going to be speaking from the heart. Behind me, this is a favourite spot of mine. I often come down here. I have done over the last 14 years to just spend a bit of time with God, to argue with him sometimes, praise him and thank him, and just sort my head out at times. And it's a favourite spot for my grandchildren to go down behind this big tree here, and they have a bit of a fire and eat up some hot dogs or burgers. This is a beech tree. The trees around about, the pine trees, are probably about 40, 50 year old. I estimate from measuring the circumference, this beech tree is nearer 300 years old. It's been around for a while. I wonder what the secret of its success is. Well, I think there's a hint in Jeremiah, the Old Testament prophet, in Jeremiah chapter 17. And it's a hint to us as well, because it starts, "But blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought, and it never fails to bear fruit." How do you feel this morning? Are you tapped? Do you have your roots going into our Lord Jesus? And are you bearing fruit? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, just pray this morning that you will speak to us afresh during the service, through the prayer, through the worship, through the messages. Father, just speak peace into our hearts and minds if they are troubled. Lord, help us to realize that our strength does not come from ourselves, but it comes from you. You've promised never to leave us or forsake us. Help us, Father, to experience your peace and to pass it on to others. Lord, we pray for our country at this troubled time. We pray for our government, that you will give them wisdom, Lord, in dealing with this terrible pandemic that we have. We pray for our local government, Father, who have made difficult decisions this week. Lord, we pray for wisdom for them. And we pray for our neighbours and friends, Lord, that we might seek you, find you. Help us to be good witnesses in this area and throughout the world. We ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Now on with the service.
Thank you. Just imagine, you're out for a walk one afternoon, perhaps you're walking the dog, just going down the street and minding your own business, enjoying the afternoon. You turn the corner and there in front of you is an enormous 7-ton African elephant, angry as anything, charging at you with his trunk raised and his ears flapping, his eyes red and mean and trumpeting really loudly. Well, instantly, several changes will happen to your body. Your heart will start thumping really loudly. Your breathing will get shallow and really quick. Your face will go pale, but your pupils of your eyes will get huge. You start shaking all over. And you might start to feel sick. Your mouth would go dry. Now, all of this is because of something called adrenaline. Adrenaline floods your body when you're facing danger to shut down unimportant things like digesting your lunch, but give you lots of energy for doing something really important like running away, flight, or standing your ground and fighting to defend yourself. This is a really good thing. This is why human beings have survived for so long, because adrenaline has got them out of difficult situations or helped them get control of difficult situations. But sometimes when we get too scared or too stressed or under too much pressure, too much adrenaline floods the system and we can't fight or fly away. We just freeze. Jesus' friend Peter was no stranger to adrenaline. He was a big man and strong, and he was used to dealing with danger. He'd been calm during storms, keeping on sailing his boat and getting back safely to shore. He'd been calm when they caught so many fish that it nearly tipped the boat over and nearly made them sink. He just got on and got the job done. He was good in a difficult situation, fighting to protect himself and those he loved. But sometimes when his adrenaline levels got a bit too high, he would say something stupid. Like when he was on the Mount of Transfiguration with Jesus and Moses and Elijah. Or when he was under pressure to say that he knew Jesus when Jesus had been arrested. Or he would do something stupid, like when he reacted too quickly and chopped off someone's ear just as Jesus was being arrested. There was one occasion, though, when things really got out of hand and Peter had a full-blown panic attack. You see, it had been a really busy, busy day. Thousands of people crowding around them to hear Jesus speak. And at the end of the day, Jesus sent his friends off in a boat to the other side of the lake, while he dismissed the crowds and then he went up onto a mountain to pray. In the middle of the night, a wind had blown up, and Jesus looked out over the lake. He could see the boat that the disciples were on, caught up in the waves and the wind, really struggling to make any headway. And he decided to go to them, walking on the water. Well, of course, that might seem completely strange, because people can't walk on water. But Jesus was God. He was the one that invented water. He was the one that got two atoms of hydrogen and mixed them together with an atom of oxygen and decided that that was going to be water. Liquid in some forms, solid in other forms, gas in another form. So having made it himself, he could just do what he liked with it, and he was walking on it. Out he walked across the lake to where the disciples were rowing with their boat, trying to make headway against the wind. Well, imagine in the middle of the night, in the middle of a lake, in the middle of a storm, if you looked up and there was somebody walking towards you. The disciples were terrified. boy, their adrenaline levels were high. They were really scared. They said, "It's a ghost." And Jesus said, "Calm down, don't worry. It's not a ghost, it's me." Well, Peter's fight instinct kicked in and he said, "Well, Lord, if it really is you, let me come to you walking on the water." "Come on then," said Jesus. And Peter stepped out of the boat, adrenaline really high, and started walking on the water to Jesus. And then things overloaded. Oh my goodness. Peter suddenly thought, "What am I doing? Humans can't walk on water. I'm stuck in the middle of this lake, walking on the water. I'm going to sink." And he did. He froze. He started sinking. And thought, "Jesus, I'm going to drown. Please save me." Well, Jesus was there in an instant and took hold of his hand and pulled him out of the water and got him into the boat. Instantly, the wind died down and they were at the shore, and everybody worshipped Jesus. They realized how amazing he was. Several times in the Bible, God tells us that we don't need to get into a panic when adrenaline levels get really high. In Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10, he says, "Don't be afraid. I'm with you. Don't tremble with fear. I am your God. I will make you strong as I protect you with my arm." And that's exactly what he did for Peter, wasn't it? He told Peter not to get into such a fright, and he protected him with his arm. "Don't be afraid. I'm with you. Don't tremble with fear. I am your God. I will make you strong as I protect you with my arm." Isaiah 41, verse 10. Now, if you can learn that verse and record yourself saying it, please send me a clip of it so we can include that in next week's service. You know, sometimes you can feel yourself starting to get in a bit of a panic. You can feel yourself freezing up. And one of the good things to do then is to breathe deeply, to imagine that you're trying to get air down into the bottom corners of your lungs, and then breathe it all out. And just to make you breathe slow enough and deep enough, try, as you breathe in, saying, "Alleluia," and then hold it for four. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then breathe out, saying, "Praise the Lord." Do that about 5 times. Then turn it around, and as you breathe in, say, "Praise the Lord." 1, 2, 3, 4, hallelujah. And do that about 5 times. After about 10 deep breaths, you should be feeling a lot calmer. Well, I hope you enjoy this week's activities. See you all next week. Bye-bye.
Prayer of lament over the coronavirus pandemic. Hear our cry, Almighty God. Listen to our prayer. How long will we have to hide in our homes from this invisible enemy? Where will it strike next? And whom? And what if? Our screens relay a continuous escalation of suffering and death around the world. Panic and anxiety abounds. Our souls are weary from the strain of the life-altering unknowns. Heavenly Father, from the depths of our pain and confusion, we cry out to you. From fear-filled hearts and anxious minds, we plead with you. Rescue us, Father of compassion and grace. We lift up our eyes to you, Lord God, the one who sits enthroned in heaven. On all who have contracted the virus, Lord, have mercy. On all who have lost loved ones to this sickness and are in mourning and anguish, Lord, have mercy. On all who are unable to earn an income because their jobs have been suspended, Lord, have mercy. We cry out for healing and needed resources. We cry out for comfort and peace. On all medical professionals and caretakers attending those infected with the virus, Lord, have mercy. on all scientists and technologists striving to find a vaccine and to make it available. Lord, have mercy. On all leaders of institutions and governments as they make decisions to try and contain the virus. Lord, have mercy. We pray for strength in the long and exhausting hours of labour. We pray for wisdom in the research and difficult decisions. On all who have not yet contracted the virus, Lord, have mercy. On the most vulnerable of our society who are unable to buy extra food or get proper medical attention, Lord, have mercy. On all disciples of Jesus Christ discerning how to reflect his love to others within this crisis, Lord, have mercy. We plead for protection of health. We plead for all to remain calm and kind. The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the expanse of the universe, and yet this earth is no longer as you created it to be. Holy Father, our earth groans from the devastation caused by the curse of the fall. My God, your word is true. One day you will liberate creation from its bondage to decay and death. Life is sacred and precious in your sight. You are the God who sees us and sustains us. Nothing can separate us from the Father's unfailing love and kindness, not even sickness or the fear of tomorrow. You are our light as we walk in this darkness. We will remember to celebrate the beautiful gifts you have given us in this present moment. Almighty God, you are a rock, our refuge from the enemy, our hiding place. You calm our frantic thoughts and fill our despairing hearts with joy and strength. In your presence, living water springs forth in the wilderness. You restore our souls. Amen.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you, I worship you. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 We make a miracle work. Promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I can see it, you're working. Even when I can feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. We make a miracle worker, promise.
the speaking on giving this morning, and we've just done the season on blessed, broken and given. And I'll be reading from John chapter 4, John 21. And in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, and the disciples did not realize that was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, have you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." When they did, they weren't able to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, torn the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. When they had landed, they saw a fire of burning coals with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you've just caught." Simon Peter, with so many of the net, was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took bread and gave it to them, and the same with the fish. This is how the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. When he had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these?" "Yes," said the Lord. "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus had asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all these things. You know I have loved you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep. I tell you the truth, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and you went where you wanted. When you were old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you to where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." So we pick up the story where the disciples had just trekked over 70 miles over rough terrain and mountains, and they had gone back to the beginning. They'd gone back to the Sea of Galilee, and they'd gone back to what they knew. And what they knew was to go back to fishing. Now, this is the final appearance of Jesus that after his resurrection, and he sat down with them and he ate with them. And I just think that is just a wonderful picture of Jesus. I think it's a wonderful picture that Jesus has for us, that he wants to sit down and he wants to be with us. He wants us to sit down and to be in his presence. Now, the first that didn't know that was Jesus, it was a stranger. And I want to ask you this morning, is Jesus a stranger to you? We've had a really rough time over this pandemic, and some people have been reading the Word of God, been praying, and some people have been asking the question, well, where is God? Why is he not doing more? And I want to say to you that God is still here, he's still ever present, and he's still with us at these very, very difficult times. And I can remember years ago when I was first a Christian, and we would meet in house groups and we would read the Word of God and we would learn Bible verses. And one of the Bible verses I very first learned as a Christian, it's still, for me, it's still very close to my heart, and it brings me close to the Lord in my times of need, in my times of brokenness, and in my times of confusion. And the Bible verse is from Isaiah, and it says, "See, I have engraved you on the palm of my hand." So this morning, only if you want to, you hold out your hands, and I want you to take your hand and want to write your own name on the palm of your hand and say with me, "See, I have engraved your name on the palm of my hand." And for me, it's just a picture that Jesus is saying, "I know you. I know you by name. I know how many hairs is on your head. I know when your heart is soaring, and I know when your heart breaks. I know you." And God knows us all. And like Jesus knew Peter, God knew us all. He knows our mistakes. He knows when when we're not living the life that we should be living, when we declare ourselves Christians. He knows that when we're broken. He's still there with us. He knows that when we are proclaiming his name, when we are with him and he's with us, he knows everything about us. And I think that's a lovely picture of Jesus going and eating with his disciples, but also it's a lovely picture of Jesus going back to Peter, because as we know, Peter denied Jesus 3 times, and I think God wanted Jesus wanted Peter to know that he was forgiven, that yes, he'd made a mistake, but he could begin again. And I think sometimes for us, we do make mistakes as Christians, we do make mistakes, we are only human. And I want you to think back to the time when you first became a Christian. I've been a Christian for many years now, over 20 years now. And as I said, when I was first a Christian, we'd read the Word of God together, we'd pray together, we were learning Bible verses together, and you know, we were, I would say, soaked in the Word of God. And Ravi Zachariah, he's a Christian communicator, he's fantastic. He says you have to be steeped, soaked daily in the Word of God to live the life God has called you. Because I think in the world that we live in a broken and confused world with many temptations. But when we are soaked, when we are immersed in the Word of God, I believe that will help us. It'll help us when we are talking about Jesus. It'll help us when we are going through difficult seasons or when we are asked difficult questions. And I want to encourage you today to go back to reading your Bible, to pick your Bible up, to be soaked in the Word of God. And to go back to remembering where you were when you were a Christian. Remember where you were. Remember who you were with. Remember those times where God spoke to you. Because I think this world just would like to steal that gift that God has given us, steal that gift of knowing God, steal that gift that we are loved by God, that our names are in the palm of his hand. And we heard last week that when we're broken about Terry and his pottery, that you're broken and you come back stronger. You know, like the pottery is put together with tiny, tiny little gold flakes and it's made stronger and it's an art. And I felt it was a lovely picture for our lives that sometimes we are broken. And the Word of God is the gold that's putting us back together, that's weaving us back together, that's making us stronger in this broken world. And, you know, I can remember that my mum, when she became a Christian, she was in the little Catholic church and, you know, she heard the song and she loved the song, such love, pure as the driven snow, such love weeps for the shame I know. And I feel like God, you know, with the pandemic and everything on, you saying, just come and sit in my presence, come and sit with me and I will bring you comfort, I will bring you what you need in this time of uncertainty. And I think sometimes when we go back to the beginning, when we go back to remembering all the times that God's spoken to us, all the times that God's been there for us, it does give us strength and we can draw on that strength in order for others who may not be in the same place as us or others who are not Christians who ask for difficult questions. And I have been asked over these last months, well, where is your God? Where is your God in this and where is God in that? And can you still believe in God? And I have to say the answer is yes. And even though that, you know, my family or myself, I can say we've gone through an extremely difficult season. We are going through an extremely difficult season. I've had to go back to the beginning many times. I had to go back to the beginning and sit in the presence of God. And I would encourage every one of you to go back to that. And remember when, you know, God first spoke to me. Remember when, you know, the Bible came alive. Not that it isn't now, but sometimes I think we get so layered up with we have work to do, we have, you know, our lives, and, you know, some people have been furloughed in the pandemic and some people have had to work through it, but it's been a time, I would say, of uncertainty. And, you know, I just like to say to you, just sit and take some time and be in the presence of God. We do a thing. I do a thing at work and a thing at home. It's called reflective practice. And you breathe in for 3 and breathe out for 6. And I always breathe in and breathe out. And I always And I try to reflect on the word of God. So I breathe in for 3 and out for 6. Again, do it with me. And you can feel like all those cares and all these worries and all the things that are going through your mind and racing through your heart, and you know, all some times you're uncertain of yourself, and sometimes with doubt. Again, breathe in, breathe out. Then we can start to reflect and we can remember the word of God, the truth of the word of God. Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. You see, I have your name engraved on the palm of my hand. God's saying that to each and every one of us today. And I know that through this pandemic, I know that some people have been really worried and really confused and had doubt. Again, God's saying here, you see, I have your name engraved on the palm of my hand. And I want you to take that verse. I want you to find that verse this week. And I want you to reflect on it. I want you to think on it. And I want you to learn it. I want you to learn that verse. And message Geraldine, message us and tell me, you know, when you're sitting in the presence of God, like how you felt, and that it brought back comfort, it brought back your strength, it brought back wisdom, and it brought back you back into how much you were deeply loved. Even in this time of uncertainty, this time of brokenness, that you are still deeply loved. And I love this story of Jesus going back to Peter. I love it because, you know, we all can remember when we've made mistakes. We all can remember when we've had an argument. And I know when Stuart was speaking a couple of weeks ago, and he was speaking, and it said, Agar said, where are you going? Where have you come from? I remember years and years ago, it was over 30 years ago, I was standing in my nana's living room and I was leaving to go and work on the Eloise. And I said to her, I'll never come back here. I'll never ever come back here. And my nana says, where are you going? And I looked around and I says, well, you know where I'm going? And she says, don't forget where you've come from. And she had just had that story read to her out of the Bible. And I looked around and she says, God will have his hand on your life. And I remember laughing, thinking, ha, God will have his hand on my life. I was running away from God. I was running away from everything. I didn't want religion. I didn't want faith. I didn't want to read the word of God. And, you know, now I've come full circle. I came back home and I became a Christian. And I just remember that in that moment, those verses, that those words stuck with me. And it was very powerful and moving moment in my nana's little living room. It wasn't until years later I became a Christian that she spoke that blessing over me, that God will have his hand on your life. And I'm saying to you now, those of us who are Christians and those of us who know the Lord Jesus, you know, God doesn't want you to run from him. He wants you to come back and to be in his presence. He wants you because he loves you so much. If you knew how much God loved you, you'd want to spend time with him every single day. And when I think of that story with Peter, I love it because you can picture the scene where Peter denied Jesus. You know, you can picture it where there he was, and he had said, I will, you know, defend you to the bitter end. You are my friend, but you are my Lord. I have seen the miracles. I have witnessed. I know who you are. And then when he was arrested and took away, Peter was there, and a servant girl first asked him. He was mulling around and he was like, you know, in with the crowds, and there was loads of people, and you could imagine the talk was, they will have arrested Jesus. Do you know that Jesus has been arrested? And then someone said, well, were you not with him? And he was like, no, not me. And inside he was like, oh, I've just denied him. But that'll be all right, it'll be all right. Just a girl, she'll not know. And then again, somebody else asked him, another servant girl, were you not with him? Were you not one of the followers of Jesus? No, not me. And then the third time, he strongly denies it. And it says he uses bad words. Not me, not I. I was not with him. And then the cock crows and he stops. And then what he knows, that he's denied his friend and his Lord. And then He weeps bitterly, and for me, that's one of the most moving verses in the Bible, because I feel he was in that moment where he was frightened, he was confused, he didn't know, he didn't take any time out, and he just said, no, not me, three times. And then the word of Jesus came back to him and said, you will deny me three times. And he went out and he wept bitterly. And I think at times we've all been in that position where we've all done things wrong, we've all said things we shouldn't, and yet Jesus forgives us. And that's why I love this story. He went and he was on the shore, he told them how to catch fish again, he sat and he ate fish with them, and then he said to Peter, do you love me? And Peter was like, yes. And I think it's in its simplest terms. I know there's lots of, you know, scholars and lots of people who wrote why Jesus asked for it, why he asked him to feed his sheep, and why he asked to love me. I'm just going to read you them Bible verses again. And it says, when he finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. And I think, again, that was the first time he denied him. So Jesus was saying, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know I love you more than these. And Peter would have been thinking, yeah, I did love you at that time as well. But I just was frightened. I just was fearful. I just didn't have the strength. You know I love you more than these. Jesus said, feed my lambs. And again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And he answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. The second denial. Again, Peter and his men would have been like, well, I denied you second time, but I do love you. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked the third time, do you love me? And the Lord, you know all things, and you know I love you. And then for me, that's the realization that Peter gets. Yes, Lord, you know all things, and you know that I love you. The third denial, forgiven. And Peter goes on to do great things. He was forgiven. His life is a testimony that we can make mistakes, that we can get it wrong. But when we have a deep relationship with Jesus, we can always repent and we can always begin again. And for me, that's what that story is about. It's for Jesus, for Peter. He's made mistakes, he's repented, and he begins again. And I feel that that's a real good example for our lives. And we can make mistakes, we can repent, and we can begin again. And in that beginning again, our lives can be given out, you know, in order to glorify the Lord Jesus. In life, I feel we all go through times of brokenness, we all go through times of betrayal, we all go through times of uncertainty and doubt, and we've all asked the question, why? Why, Lord? And I think we just have to accept that God is sovereign. He's sovereign over all. And if we go back to Genesis, if we read in the beginning that God created the earth and God created the land, the sea, the stars, the moon, the sun, he created it all for us. And I think sometimes it's good just to take a moment to reflect on creation. Now, we were at the caravan and we had 4 days. There was just the four of us. We went and we never saw or spoke to them, and it was wonderful. We got up, went for walks along the beach, we prayed, we came back and we ate some lovely food. And on our way home, my grandson, we'd gone for our last walk along the beach. I drove along the coastline and we had gone along the beach and we had jumped in the sea and done some really nice things. And then when we were coming out, he said to me, Nana, look at that, it's fantastic. And I turned around fully expecting to show me some Lego creation he made, because he makes some fantastic Lego creations. I have to say, we buy him a nice Lego set. We bought him a nice fighter plane, and you know, my husband very carefully built it up for over an hour, and it was wonderful. And then he unbuilds it and he makes himself something else. So I was expecting to see a lovely, wonderful Lego creation. And I turned round and he was looking out the window and he was looking this way. And I looked out my window and it was the sky and the coastline and the sea. And I looked and I says, yes. I says, it is. It's fantastic. And he says, Nana, it's magnificent. And I thought, it is creation. It's there for all to see. The wonder of the sky, the earth, the sun, the stars, the moon. It is magnificent. And then he said to me, "Now lend me your phone. I think we need to take a picture of this." I'll put the pictures on after this message. And I just thought to myself, that is from a young boy who actually gets the wonder of God. And I want to encourage you, this week to take time out to spend time in God's presence, to take time out and to learn the Bible verse, "See, I have you engraved on the palms of my hands." And I want you to tell us, to be encouraging each other, to encourage us together. And yes, we may have failed. Yes, we may have not been great through the pandemic. There's always time to repent and to begin again. And I feel as Christians for our lives, for when we talk about giving our lives out, I feel we can only do that if we are steeped, soaked, saturated in the Word of God. Because I do believe in this world that the enemy seeks to destroy and seeks to steal and seeks to pull us down. And God doesn't want that. And after this message, we're going to sing, well, I'm not going to sing, I shan't inflict that on you. We're going to say, Paul is going to sing "Such Love." And I want you just to take some time to listen to that song and to really take on board the love that the Lord Jesus has for you, as he had for his disciples. I think it's a lovely picture of God as man. And he went back and he found Peter and he had some food with him. And then he forgave him there in front of the disciples. Because even though Peter had seen him after the resurrection, I still think it would have still been within his heart. Yeah, God forgives me. Yeah, God loves me. Oh, I wish I hadn't denied him. I wish I had been stronger. I wish I had fought more for him. I wish I had said that. We've all been, I wish I. But God went back, and that's the picture. God's coming back for you today. God's saying to you, wherever you are, come, spend some time with me. Come, be soaked in the Word of God. Be soaked in my presence. Let me give you peace. Let me give you rest. Let me just pray for you now. Lord God, I lift everyone up who is watching this and everyone who has had a difficult time, Lord, of late, everyone who feels lost, lonely and broken. I pray, Father God, that you will just be there late in this difficult time. That such love that you have for us will just spill out into their lives, minds and heart, Father. In Jesus' name, I pray this. Amen. May God keep you safe this week. Look after yourself and each other. See you soon.
Such love, pure as the whitest snow. Such love weeps for the shame I know. Such love, paying the debt I owe. Oh, Jesus, such love, such love, stilling my restlessness. Such love, filling my emptiness. Such love, showing me holiness. Oh, Jesus, such love, such love, springs from eternity. Such love, streaming through history. Such love, fountain of life to me. Oh Jesus, such love. Such love, pure as the widest snow. Such love weeps for the shame I know. Such love, paying the debt I owe. Oh Jesus, such love. Oh Jesus, such love. Oh Jesus, such love.
Welcome back. I'm standing under the canopy of the big beech tree that I mentioned earlier. I trust this morning that you've been blessed by being partaking in this service, that the messages have spoken into your circumstances. I'm sure Esther's message about Peter walking in the water and Corinne's message to us this morning has spoken and touched many of us. If you feel that you need prayer this morning, don't hesitate to use the prayer button or contact us via the website and somebody will pray with you in confidence. Whether you know the Lord Jesus or you don't know the Lord Jesus, we often need help and don't be afraid to ask for it. Our prayer this morning is that if you don't know the Lord Jesus, that you will not wait any longer, that you will commit to him this morning before this service closes. Don't forget the Zoom coffee and chat, 12:15. The details to log in are on the screen at the side. Alternatively, check your email from the newsletter during the week. Thank you for being with us. Stay safe. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, just thank you for your many blessings towards us. Thank you, Lord, that we have roots, if we know you, that extend into the Lord Jesus. We are not relying on our own strength, Lord, to get through this, but on yours. Help us to stay safe, we pray. Lord, I pray a blessing on all who've witnessed, taken part in this service this morning. Give them a good week, Lord, and help them to be a help to those round about them. We ask these things to bring glory to the Lord Jesus. Amen.
And I thought I was so wise, but then you took me by surprise. Like waking up from the long guess.
lost in a fantasy that blinded me. Until your love broke through. All my life I've been searching for that crazy missing part, and with one touch, Lord, you rolled away the stone that held my heart. And now I see that the answer was as easy as just asking you in. And I am so sure I could never doubt your gentle touch again. It's like the power of the wind, like waking up from the longest dream. How real it seemed until your love broke through. I've been lost in a fantasy that blinded me. Until your love, your love broke through. Until your